Hey, g'day, it's Prezo here, back in the shop today, and this is episode 4 of building a DIY sand muller for the Home Foundry. In today's episode, we're going to look at the last of the items to make this into a functioning tool, and they are the ploughs, or the rakes, I'm not sure of the correct term, but what they do is they scrape the sand and direct it underneath this very heavy steel roller. The roller is what does the mixing and churning and crushing of the sand and prepares it for the sand mold. We're also going to look at the painting and the electrical side of things, and just basically getting this looking nice and tidy and finished. I corrected the rather embarrassing blunder I made in the last episode, where I had this arm straight and it was scraping on the edge of the drum, so I've cut and re-welded that, put that kink in it, and that solves that problem. So let's head over to the bench and let's look at the first of the steel ploughs that are going to be used to get our sand running in the right direction to be underneath this roller. Just been working on the ploughs. The ploughs are the things that are going to push the sand underneath the big roller. And I've drawn out here the two tracks. This is the inner track and the outer track is just here. The drum itself rotates anti-clockwise. So any sand on this inside circle has to be pushed out, and any sand on the outside of that circle has to be pushed inwards. The outer plough is pretty straightforward. This is just a piece of steel, 120 millimeters wide. It's got a slight curve on it just to pick the sand up, push it to that inside track. This one here though is a little bit more difficult. It's sort of like a J shape. Got to keep the whole of that center of the disc clear. There are going to be a pair of arms which will be adjustable. So these can be moved up and down, we can rotate them, and we can slide them side to side. So what we're going to do now is we're going to try and bend this piece up. So I've got a piece of stock ready and we're going to look at that. Just to do this J-shaped bend, I'm using some 50mm wide by 6mm thick hot rolled steel. And I'm using this Hosfelt clone bender. I saw this on this old Tony's video. I'll put a link in the description if you want to check it out. These things are very versatile, but like all benders, they do some things really well and other things they don't. And I found that in my shop, I've got to have, you know, three or four different benders to do the whole range of what I like to do. And the trouble is they take up a lot of space. I've got a series of dies just made out of just whatever stock I've got lying around. And you can configure this to do pretty much any diameter bend up the capacity of these pinholes on top here, as long as you've got the correct shape dies. So I'm going to have a go at this. So I've marked out the length of straight section on the J that I want, and that's going to go up against the tangent point on this large diameter die here. Then the roller will pull the stock round through the number of degrees that I want. The thing I used to teach students at school was always leave your stock oversize if you can. If it's oversized, you've got options. Once you cut your stock to length, you're committed. If you've got something wrong, you've got nowhere to go. So although I've marked out the tangent point here, I'm going to cut a bit extra and then I'll trim it back later. So that's going to go, let's see, in like that. And you see the tangent point, it's actually pushed back a little bit. So just keep all that resting down there and we just come round and I'm going to hit my camera. Okay, I've got to reposition the camera. Okay, that's better. And once again, I'm going to take a little bit extra here. I'll trim it later. Okay, I'm going to put this in the drum and I'll just check that I've got enough here. I can always put it back and cut or bend a little bit more if I need to. There you go, I do need some more. So let's go a bit further. That makes short work of that. That's, you know, like I say, 5 millimeters thick, 50 wide, does a pretty good job. And the die here doesn't need to be the full height of the stock that you've got. Okay, well, I just trimmed that on this end and laid it over the top of the drawing that I had. And now I can mark off where this inner track starts, and then we'll trim that, and then we can weld our arm on. These are the attachment points for the ploughs, and I'm just going to weld down the side of this 25 millimeter square tube. And these are slotted so that I can adjust these left and right. The plough will be able to be moved up and down in that tube, and it can be rotated as well. So I've got three axes of movement. So I'll just go ahead and get these welded, but I'm not going to show you because there's two things I'm sure of. I can't weld and I can't dance. Anyway, real men don't dance, they have bad backs. Hey, I'm getting better. That's at least one good one anyway. Good for me. Got these ploughs cut to length now, and I've arranged them so the trailing edge, which is this one and this one here, they're lined up with the track where the roller will run. These rods haven't been welded on yet, and I'm about to do that. I wanted to get them more or less in the center of each plough so that the force on the plough was pretty much balanced. This plough here is the one that shifts the majority of the sand, and it's going to push it out to this point here. So once again, I wanted this rod to be pretty much in the center of the plough. These brackets are adjustable, as I said, left and right, and I've got to mark out and drill through the frame, put some captive nuts on the back, and then we've got some adjustment there. That's, we can sort of maneuver things around to get it right. I did have to cut this plate down to 15 millimeters wide so it shipped over the edge of the drum just to get the geometry of this one right. Just got this back in the Muller now. I've just got this one central plough done. I don't know if it's a plough or a rake, I'm not sure. But what I can do now is I can get some adjustment left and right. Not so important for this one, but for the other one that's got to be very close to the edge of the drum, that will be important. And we can also get some vertical height adjustment, and we can pivot that as well. So there's plenty of room there to fine tune that to get the ploughing action, raking action correct. So let's do the electrical. Okay, electrical. The only thing I need here is a switch, and I wanted to have a timer on this because when you run this Muller, it typically takes about 10 minutes for a cycle, and I realized that there was every possibility I'd turn this thing on and walk away and just forget about it, and you'd come back like 2 hours later and find the thing was just sort of grinding its way through the bottom of the drum. So I did want to have a timer. Now these are an old analog style, well, it's actually a new switch, but it's from an old analog style microwave oven timer. They time up 60 minutes. They've just got a switch here and a little dinky bell on the back there. It goes off when the time period is elapsed. Never going to hear the bell, but at least it turns itself off. So I also showed you this little plastic case, and these are available from J Car Electronics here in Australia, and they're great because they've got a silicon seal in the back of the lid, and they've got good quality plastic brass fittings where the screws go in, and you can tighten these things down, and they're relatively weather tight. I even went to the trouble of laser etching and cutting a scutcheon plate for this. And I thought, oh, life's good, everything's working out. And I went to fit this yesterday, and, well, somewhere along the line, I went into dumbass mode. I think I just held the switch up against the case there and thought, yeah, that'll fit, that's not a problem. When I went to put it all together and compress the seal, it was about 2 millimeters narrower than it should have been. So it just, well, doesn't fit. So, what do you do? Well, I wasn't happy, I can tell you that. So what I've done instead is I've got some of this 50 millimeter aluminium tubing. Now the switch just fits in there by good fortune. So it slides down through that slot there, and there are a pair of holes so I can line up, screw that switch in there tight. Now I had to rejig the plastic scutcheon plate for that. just make it a little bit narrower, but I got that to work. And I'm going to cap the top and the bottom with these injection molded post caps. This bottom one's already got the grommets in it for the cable entry and outlet point. And I know people are saying right now, oh, you shouldn't use aluminium, you know, for a switch carrying mains voltage. Don't worry, I'm going to earth everything really well. I've got an earth leakage circuit breaker on my power here in the garage. So, look, if it's for me, I'm willing to back it and say it's going to be safe. I wouldn't do it for anybody else. I know people panic about, you know, having metal in contact or anywhere near mains voltage. Don't worry, it will be safe. So what we're going to do now is get all this powder coated. Oh, and I made a bracket. This is going to go on the back like that. There we go. And that's going to screw onto the frame of the muller. So I'm going to get all this powder coated and ready to go on, and then we'll wire it up, and I'm confident it's going to work. I thought it through. Trust me. So just in terms of electrical, I've got these fully insulated crimp connectors on for the active. The neutrals will just be joined together with one of these fully insulated couplings, and the earths, they're going to be joined together on the back of this housing with a 3mm screw. So we got earth in contact with all the metal. So I'm just going to hook this together temporarily because it's all going to come apart for powder coat and paint. Okay, I know this looks a bit untidy, but don't forget all of that wiring is going to be pushed up inside that box there. Get our plastic caps, top and bottom. I'm going to anchor my cables against the side of the leg there. And let's just set it for 10 minutes, see how it goes. And let's pretend 10 minutes has elapsed. Ah, there's the bell, so it's all done. Okay, so let's get this stripped down now and ready for paint and powder coat. Oh, and for anybody with eagle eyes, yes, that's where I had the other plastic switch box mounted, which of course now is redundant. Yeah, that's really annoying. Here are all the parts that have been powder coated and ready to go back together. I chose to do powder coat because it's more durable, simple, and it doesn't require solvents, it doesn't require any sort of drying time or cleaning up. Some of these big heavy parts took quite a long time in the oven, around about half an hour, but what you get out of the oven is beautifully finished, and like I say, it's chip resistant, it's wear resistant, and it doesn't require a lot of preparation apart from a bit of cleaning. So I'm going to do all the sub-assemblies, get those together, and then we can go ahead and paint the frame. The frame's over here. So these are the bits that I can't fit in my powder coat oven, so they'll be done in a two-pack etch primer and then a black top coat, probably a two-pack top coat as well. As far as the drum goes, I'm going to leave that just as sanded aluminium, but this top edge, because of that gap that's in it, I felt like that was going to get filled up with sand and water. So what I've decided to do is to fill that with some timber. So it's just going to be pressed down into that gap. This is the off-cut that I didn't use. I'm going to super glue that in, just run some thin super glue along that edge to bond it in there. I'll sand that flush with the top of the aluminium, and I'm just going to paint that strip, that's all. The rest can stay as it is. This is my big ass chunk of lead, which comes in handy when you're doing this sort of job. So I'm just going to clean up this wooden edge and give that a sand. Got everything masked off and cleaned, so it's all degreased, so I'm ready to start spraying. Nah, just kidding. Just while I'm waiting for this to cure a bit so I can turn it over, I thought I'd tell you about the paint that I'm using. It's a two-pack epoxy finish. This is Valspar. It's a 400 series. This is just the hardener. And I find that it sticks really well to galvanized steel or any sort of metal for that matter, provided it's clean and provided you mixed it at the correct ratio, which is 3:1. The problem is now that I've got to be able to turn this over or turn it upright to get at the rest of it. And because it's such a bulky, awkward thing, it's every chance I'm going to smear it or scratch it while I try and turn it over. So I'm not going to show you that, because it's bound to be gymnastic exercise, but we'll get it, you know, upright and see if we can get the rest of the paint on. Well, sometimes you just got to do some lateral thinking here. So I've got a resting on the axles at this end, which don't need to be painted. The other end, I've got a block of wood with a nail in it just to support underneath there. So I can do all of this side now. And we'll let that cure. Okay, ideal day for spraying. There's absolutely zero wind. Doing this outdoors, and I'm using a two-pack black gloss for the top coat.
I think we're done. It's going to let that cure. Let's hope that we don't get any dust falling on it. Wish I had a spray booth.
Well, pilgrims, here it is. I got it all assembled this morning, or at least everything except the drum. Most of the major hardware components have all been bolted down now and fixed permanently. Here's the switch, powder coated with its end caps on, and that all works. Cute little bell when it goes off. I've anchored the cables against the side of the leg here so they're fixed firmly in place as well. Okay, have a look around this side here, and you can see the belt's been tensioned up. I've fitted a PVC cap for the bearing. The nut's been tensioned up and lock wired in place. Got grease in there as well. And that's also going to serve to locate the underside of the drum and keep it central on this plate. Up here we got the powder-coated attachment points for the ploughs. The ploughs are just loose in there at the moment. They'll be set permanently when the drum's in place. I fitted end caps to all of the tubing just to stop rodents and bugs and insects from getting in there and moisture. So that's all good. So, last thing I want to do here is fit a wooden handle to this. So let's get that made and get it fitted.
Thank you.
Ah, what a relief. What? Stop snickering.
Okay, it's all assembled. I've just run the drum and I put the roller in the drum and I've set the ploughs so they're a little bit clear of the sides of the drum and the base of the drum. That's probably going to have to be fine-tuned, but let's just run it and see how it looks. The important thing here is that the ploughs don't actually scrape on the drum anywhere, but they've got to be really close to it. Now, $64,000 question. Will it actually mull any sand? This is the condition of the green sand after it comes out of the mold. So it's dry, it's compacted, it's really difficult to break up. If you use your hands, that's the process you have to use. So let's dump some of this in and see how we go. And trust me, I haven't tried this yet. So far, so good. Let's do a bit of rolling action. Oh no! Oh, there we go. Maybe. Okay, all good now. Still got a few lumps. There's certainly not a problem with power. It's rotating that. No sign of the motor stalling or laboring at all. This plough seems to be picking up the sand, moving it into the center under the roller. It's been going for about 5 minutes. As you see, there's still lumps in it. So I'm gonna put some water in now and see if that makes a difference. I've noticed that it's sort of rolling out back to the edge of the drum after it's passed this plough over here. And some of those lumps aren't going through the roller. But if we get that wet, it'll be a different story. Certainly behaves differently when it's got water in it. I think I've overdone the water. That's way too moist. So it's going to take a while to actually get some proportions so I know how much sand, how much water. But you see now that it's actually forming a definite track under the roller and it's keeping the center and the edge of the drum clean. So let me just put a bit more dry sand in. Well, that's sort of starting to get to the stage where I think it's usable. It's probably too moist, probably added too much water right from the get-go. I did add in a couple of scoops, or at least 4 or 5 scoops of dry sand on top of what I had before. And I did have to stop and retension the felt on the pulley. It worked its way loose. Probably going to take a while for that to sort of run in and remain tensioned uniformly. But I'm pretty happy with it so far. Certainly I'm going to have to be a bit more careful about weighing out the sand or measuring out the sand and then getting my moisture content right. But it's done what I wanted, which was to get rid of the big hard lumps and turn it over and make it homogenized, you know, get it uniform in texture. So still got a bit of work to do, certainly with you know, getting the proportions and the ratios right. But mechanically, it's sort of doing what I expected. Let's just see if it'll restart. Yeah, that's good. Something I'm noticing is that the sand tends to sort of compact under the roller. You break it up a bit, move it around, it does a better job. There's a big lump. So I've only had this running for about 5 minutes. After you put the dry sand in, there's another one. Chance I need more weight on this roller. finished mulling, the simple way to get it out is just to scoop it up. Got to be a bit careful though. There you go. So you just scoop that out. You've got to keep that center clear. I've got a feeling I got too much sand in there, really. There you go. That's pretty good. Okay, well, I think I'm going to finish this up here, and I'm sure you'll see this come up in future videos. So I think by that time I'll have this dialed in and have it running the way I want. So, oh, one more thing.